So I've got a lot of resource material that I'll be using, and I've got a lot of photographs that I've taken of this area of the Shaw Island landing, and there's a lot of boats and buildings. So I plan to include the fantail of the ferry in this one, and some of the water, and also a couple people on the fantail with bikes. And I had models for that, although they weren't in that setting. I'm kind of playing around with adding some people, and they agreed to pose, and I got up above so I had the proper perspective. And this is Ryan and his bike, and not the greatest photograph, but I can adjust the lighting and so forth to work with the Shaw Island images. And this is Claire, and they'll be standing together on the fantail of the ferry. So lots of photos are used in this painting. I'm not just working off the top of my head. There's a lot of machinery that has to be done, and working parts of the ferry landing itself, and then the stuff in the background. So yeah, I always work from a lot of photos if I can't work on site, and this is no exception. So I do most of it in the studio. So my first step here is to put a little masking fluid on the treetops, and that'll prevent the wash from the sky to get down below and affect the color that's going to go on there afterward. You might ask, well, why not just paint the trees because they're darker and then do a sky wash over the top of it? And the only reason I don't is I kind of like to keep the color pure there. If I do couple of layers over the top of a lighter wash, I'm pretty sure that it's going to be changing the color to a degree. Not a lot, but enough that might bug me. So this is what I do, and it also will provide kind of a guideline when I'm doing these evergreens, because I'll have an edge that's somewhat defined, not completely, but and I'm really just doing the tips of the limbs. And for this, I've got a this brush I'm using is a synthetic, because I don't want to ruin a good brush. It's not necessarily going to ruin your brush if you clean them with like rubber cement thinner or an adhesive remover. It should take care of the brush, but nevertheless, I like to use something other than my best for this. And I have a little sketch here, but I really kind of do my drawing with the paintbrush. It's kind of the same. Just you just can't erase. Well, with this stuff, you can actually. If you get it, something down that you don't care for, it's possible to just let it dry and just wipe it off. You have to be careful about too much of this, though, because this kind of affects the paper. It does affect the paper, and you don't want to leave it on too long. It will remove sizing
And typically what happens is when it's taken off, the areas that it resided, the color seems to settle in and become a shade darker than it would have otherwise. And I think that's because the paper's been roughed up or, disturbed the surface of this watercolor paper. No matter how you do it, with an eraser or you put an indentation in it some way. The result will be you're going to have an area that's, I wouldn't call it distressed or anything, but it's just disturbed to the point where the pigment of the paint will settle in. That's why you have to be very careful with paper. If you get a bunch of, if you scratch it, you don't have to be putting any pigment down or any pencil, but just little scratches can result in lines later that kind of show up. It's like the invisible ink trick. You don't see them until you just paint over them. So that's not optimal. And this is working with this method, you want to feel as though you're actually painting the limbs. And it's difficult to see what you're applying sometimes. And the way I keep my brush kind of pointed is just pulling it out like a with my fingernail, or you have to be willing to get some grunge on you, because you will. And as this stuff dries, it's like rubber cement, it'll ball up. And I don't think I helped myself out right there. Well, I'm cleaning most of it off just by kind of using my fingernail and that should do the job. Any little remnants, you just can sweep away. When, oop, like I said, it's not a very good brush. The ferrule just pulled off the handle. So I'm pretty tough on these. You can tell. All right. Well, there's a skyline here made by treetops, and you just want to keep your stroke kind of delicate, light. And I typically move from the center out and kind of pull away and up, and it creates the look of limbs that taper, which is what you want. And these are also very far away, so of course they don't have to be perfect. A lot of what we'll do to establish the distance in this is to use atmospheric color, so that as we move away from objects, or the further objects are away from us, the chroma is diminished. We don't see the depth of the color as much as we do when it's closer, and that's well established in painting. That's what the old masters did a lot of times to create the distance in their work, so it's alter the color atmospherically so that we got the impression that certain parts were very far away. And it's pretty easily achieved. The sky here, the color will be very light. Because as you work your way toward the horizon, typically when you look at a sky, the deepest color is over your head. And part of that is because of, again, atmospheric conditions. Because when you look toward the horizon, you're looking through more cloud or moisture. And even if it's clear day, and that tends to diffuse the color a little bit. And that's why at the horizon you typically don't see as much deep color as you do when you look overhead, because you're not looking through as much ground atmosphere, I guess I could call it. There's nothing much when you look straight up that obstructs your, well, unless it's a real cloudy day, that would obstruct your view of the, or perception of the darks. See, there's a line I'm not too fond of. I'm going to let that one, it's too thick. So I'll just let it dry and wipe it off. You know, the paintbrush is a good method for applying this stuff. But there's another. I don't know if I can demonstrate it. I don't see why I shouldn't be able to. But the sticks of various shapes, and even like a straw, something like that, these will work, and you'll get varied effects pushing the resist around. The thing I don't like about this, and I'll probably abandon this, I've experimented with a lot of different things, and they're sticks are good for removing this and pushing it around if you have a kind of a puddle of it. But for applying it initially, if you're trying to stay within your shape, I probably can't beat a brush. The thing about this is it'll kind of puddle up and release, and you'll get more than you were expecting. It's sort of like working with pen and ink, how you can sometimes get a pool up in the reservoir of the nib on the ink or on your pen. You dip it in the ink and you don't realize there's a little pool of ink nestled up in the nib, and you're drawing away and all of a sudden you get a flood, and that's a disaster. Well, this isn't a disaster. This is just a little bit inconvenient when you have to remove it, but certainly removable. When I want to clean my brush, I use adhesive thinner, adhesive remover, I guess it is. And it's stuff that I got from automotive place, just I'm sure you can find it at any of the big supply stores, you know, Home Depot and those kinds of places. I haven't really looked. In the paint section, adhesive remover. I don't really know the formula for this. I haven't read it. It would probably, if I was more of a chemist, it would be good to know, because then I could formulate something to thin it and make it so I didn't ruin the compound, the mixture. I don't think I'm going to worry about it. Well, I've got, what, 2 more feet to travel across here and applying this stuff. And then once I get it all on there, I'll come back and I'll be putting down a sky, which probably in this painting I'll turn everything upside down because I have a slight incline here. And I'll turn it the other way around so everything will run off to the top. So I'll show you what that looks like. Really simple sky. And I'll show you what I use for the mixture and the application. I'll be back in a minute. Well, I've got the outline of the trees masked with the masking fluid, and I'm experimenting with the color for the sky, and I'm looking at a combination of a number of things. I'm using a little bit of Prussian, a little bit of cerulean, and some cobalt, and playing around with the balance of that. And at this point, I think I've pretty much got what I want. It's not that critical because I'm going to do super light wash over here. And if I want to go a little darker, I could just do another one over the top. There's not a lot of feature to the sky here. And we've got to get my paper wet. I've got it cleaned. And so that will be step one. And it will be with my big soft brush here, which I have several. This is my kind of go-to. Whatever you got that's nice and soft, and the bristles are clean, of course. And you know, with watercolor, it is important how you put your water down, because that's where the paint's going. That's the vehicle for that pigment. So if you make a big puddle, that's when paint will also puddle, settle in, drop a lot of pigment, and you might not be pleased. So I like to have a little bit of an incline to my surface there I'm working on, and that prevents any areas building up too heavily. And if I get, you know, if the water runs off down onto the tape, that's fine. I'll just soak it up. I'll
also. You want to have a very light touch. You don't want to scrub your paper ever. And here's where having a very heavy paper comes in, because it'll swell with all this water, but it'll go back flat. And if I use something too light, like say 140 pound, it tends to create these waves in the paper that don't want to flatten out again. I've got a hot press, but that's kind of tricky. And also, it's hard to work on a surface that's got big waves. So, get a heavy paper. This is about 300. And you can go above that, and I do frequently, but it's anchored really well with this frog tape. I like frog tape. It seems to do the job pretty well. I don't have much of any water getting underneath it. Get that mopped up a little. And I'm just giving it a sec to kind of flow. And then if you get down and look at your paper from an angle, you can see whether there are pools of water. And I don't seem to have that going on. So I don't want too much pigment, so I'm going to be coming in from bottom up. As I said, this portion, the top actually, is going to have more color than the horizon. Well, there's not a lot of sky here, so it's going to be fairly uniform. But just gently brushing this on. And I'm not a big fan of total uniformity because, you know, I want to create a little bit of interest in my sky. Wondering why I'm tapping. There's a few areas where the light of the sky can be seen through the trees, so I'm just giving that a little bit of a treatment with tapping very lightly. I don't want to leave a bunch of paint there. Always go back to the water. You can almost never have too much water. And of course, you know, this is going to dry lighter than it appears right here. So, no, you know, I'm cautiously applying the pigment because I don't want to saturate anything. Okay, that one's got a lot. Put it over here. Painting upside down sometimes is like using your off hand. You know, if you want something very irregular, you know, it's not a bad practice to switch hands, go to your off hand, whatever it might be. If you're right handed, go to your left hand. It actually works for getting some line and shape that you might not regularly produce. If that's what you're looking for. Of course, if you want better control, you're going to go to your dominant hand. But this is what happens when you paint upside down. I don't know if I'm using the other side of my brain or if I have another side. One thing about watercolor too is when you see something you like, stay away. Let it be. Not that I'm experiencing that right now, but you can definitely overwork this part of the process. And less is more. I don't believe in brushing this paint back and forth. I like to let it do its thing. Now that is not uniformity. And I really don't want it to be. What I kind of like to do here, I think, is give this about 20 minutes. And since it's at an incline, it's not the pigment's not sitting here very well on the edge. But I'm going to see how this dries, see how light it becomes, and then I think I'm going to do another really light wash to add a little more color to the upper portion. I want it to be really light around these trees for the contrast, and that is happening, so I'm happy with that. Of course, if you don't like something, well, I should have stopped. If you don't like something you've done, you can mop it, which is just getting your brush really wet and squeezing out any pigment. And if you've got a spot that you don't care for, like I just put down, just repeatedly go back with clean water and lightly pick it up. Then you can mop up your trouble spots. And I don't have anything here that's too offensive, because at this stage, it's very early going. And this will soften up too as it dries. Plus I'm going over the top of the resist material and that's going to be coming off. So that should work for now. And I will be back in a minute to put a little more color up to the top of the paper. So, well, this has dried for a bit. I'm going to get a little bolder with my color here. I'm just barely touching this. And this is my mixture of Prussian, cerulean, and cobalt. Care for that maneuver. So I'm going to be So I'll just use a little water and dilute it and run it off. There we go. And I'm barely touching the surface as I do this. You always have to keep an eye on your paper as it dries, because it's possible to get what are called tide pools. It's where there's kind of a recess from all the water. The paper's got these mounds and valleys, and in a valley you can get an accumulation of color. And occasionally as it dries, it'll actually create a little dark edge defining the outside ring. And then you got to deal with that. So, kind of be vigilant while it dries. You want it to make visual sense. And skies don't typically have any lines. This is a jet stream. Real easy way to do some light clouds is just to use clean water and your kind of a mop brush, and you can pick up if you've got an area where you'd like a collection of clouds. It's really simple to do. I'm not doing it because I've got enough variation here already. I think it already appears that there are clouds. But we'll see how it looks when it's dry. As I said, be vigilant, stay with it. In a gently brush out any areas that are unnatural looking. I'm going for another brush here, very, very soft one that's dry and clean. You don't want any texture. So if you're seeing any texture, get a super soft clean brush and just super light brush across it, and try not to leave bristles in there like I just did. go. Now then, I don't see any area that can possibly run or pool together. So I think it's safe at this point to let this dry completely, and we'll see what we have. And even though it's gotten considerably lighter, it'll get lighter yet because, well, it hasn't really dried. It's got a long way to go, probably half an hour. And I could accelerate that, I could use a hairdryer, but I think I'm just going to let this do its thing naturally, and we'll be back. Well, I finished the sky, and I'm pretty happy with it. It's really pale, but I was looking for that. I had said that I wanted it a little deeper up above the horizon, but I guess I'll have to just do a little bit of a wash over there if I want to go any darker. Sometimes you can overwork things. It's very simple to do, so I have to be careful of that. But now my next move, after I removed the resist material that was used to kind of put a line in for the treetops, indicate where that will happen. And there's quite a bit of blue that is going to be where I'm going to be painting trees, but where I do combine my greens and the blue of the cobalt and the Prussian that I used, it's going to help create that atmospheric effect. If you blue your greens a little bit and keep it very pale, you'll have a more of a distant appearance, so that'll work for me. I've got a lot of greens already on my palette, and I'm using a piece of cardboard to protect the paper, so when I lean on it, I'm not damaging it. And then I've got some watercolor paper to experiment with, and this palette needs to be revived a little bit. It hasn't been in use for a while. I have about three palettes, and actually one of them I use for the sky when I get started, so I can keep the paints very pure. Now I'm doing the lightest value that I can detect. I've got a bunch of reference photos laying about that I look at and refer to. And these evergreens looks like a lot of firs and cedars have several shades, and I'm using hookers and an olive. What else do I have here? And I'm making some green with combinations of the blues and some yellow. Here's an example of that. And you can always experiment that way. Some of the best colors you'll ever produce will be from combinations of colors right off the color wheel. The old-fashioned way. You don't need a tube of every single thing available, because there's so many, but you can make just about anything, and they're gonna look natural. Occasionally some of these very specific colors that you can buy in tubes are a little bit synthetic appearing, at least to my eye. So if you want to keep it organic, it's kind of nice to just use a palette that you're familiar with and produce your own variations from that. You know, I'm not saying that you have to use three primaries and create everything else, but I don't like to go beyond probably 20 shades or hues of pigments that I would purchase. I don't think I need to go beyond that. And of course, we're not really using white and precious little black. So most of the colors are going to fall in the blues, browns. I tend to go back to some of the pain, you know, to the some basic reds that I like. Alizarin crimson, cadmium medium, cadmium pale yellow, cad orange. Colors that I'm sure most of you are familiar with. So it's nice also if you've got the time, the inclination, it's raining outside, you might pick up that noise, to gonna take note of what your combinations are so that you can do them again. Obviously, you can't reproduce them exactly the same every time, but that's fine because it'll give you a lot more variation on your painting. I'm going to pause for a minute and let this rain go. It's going to interfere with the sound. Okay, it calmed down a little bit. I thought I would show this palette, even though it's a bit of a mess. This is the way I have it set up. It looks kind of greenish now, but that's cad pale yellow, cad orange, yellow ochre, rose madder, cadmium red, Davies gray. I like Davies gray. Van Dyke brown, sepia, crimson, alizarin crimson. This is burnt sienna, raw umber. And then I have here burnt umber. And I'm not sure what green that is. I'm going to have to figure that one out. That's Hooker's Green Deep. That's Cobalt Olive Green. Sap Green. Payne's Gray. Cerulean Blue. Ultra Blue. Cobalt Blue. Manganese Blue. And Prussian. And that's it. It's my typical palette. There's a couple other things I get into, depending on if I'm doing buildings or, you know, a lot of architecture requires maybe some different reds or something else, depending if you're trying to match a color of paint or something like that. But for the most part, I mean, in terms of natural settings, this palette works pretty well for me. So I play with that, and I'm creating something here to get started with my trees. I'm using a kind of a big liner brush. It's got some really long bristles, so it holds a lot. And I want to just start off with touching in some very pale green. Don't want a lot of color in it. Keep it toned down. And there's a little bit of yellow in it too. Take a couple swipes here and start laying it in. Now you're working in the distance, so you've got to make sure you don't get something that's very vivid. You want to use quite a bit of water with your paint so that it's dilute and it will flow a little bit. And I'm just, my brush stroke is sort of one where I lay the tip of the brush down and just sort of pick up in the direction the limbs are going to grow. As you do that, your stroke goes from thick to thin. So by placing the tip of the brush down and pulling off to the side, you can see how much that tapered. So it goes thick to thin, no matter how small you want to go. And of course, that's what everything happens that way in nature, in a tree. You're going from the thickness, you know, like in branches, they go thick, and as they get away from the trunk, they get thinner. And so the foliage, I wouldn't call it foliage, the needles of the tree out on the limbs give this appearance also. So I want to keep that brush stroke and I'm going to overlap a lot of these. And I want my lightest value first. I don't want to be putting down anything with much intensity. Just keep a very light value. Because you can always make things darker. That's not a problem. But going the other way, not so easy. And another thing to consider is little bitty brush strokes back here, because this is very far away, so all that size diminishes with distance, and you want to keep that part of your perspective working so that you create that illusion of depth. Sounds like something Bob Ross would say. Anyway, these trees require a lot of repetition, but don't rush it. Just kind of let it develop. And I'm not really, even at this point, varying my mixture on the brush. But I am leaving a little bit of space. I'm not just filling everything with this. I'm leaving a little bit of space, which will be a darker value, but it also can be perceived as a positive and negative space relationship. So, I don't think it's a good idea, at least for me, to just paint all of the background trees a very light value and then go over them and paint them again in the next darker value and building up that way. I prefer kind of working around these spaces. And, it's almost like drawing in a sense. So you get a better feeling for your subject, I think, if you build it up gradually and work in small areas at a time, at least with something like a tree, or trees that you can see individual limbs and so forth. If this was really distant and just a forest that, you know, that required color more than anything else, then I would think about putting all one value down and then laying some others on top of it. But since this is much closer, kind of a medium ground and a medium distance, I would like to keep some of the irregularities of these brush strokes more evident and not have them all blur together.
just touching and pulling my brush up and away.
You might be thinking, hey, at this rate, it'll be done by next year. I don't ever really worry about how long it takes me to do a painting. They take however long they take, and sometimes when I'm really inspired by an idea or something I want to attack, I got a lot of energy on the to go and work on it. I can spend 8-9 hours painting, but for the most part I take breaks. I might even take a day off, and I've taken a lot of days off during this COVID period. That kind of just dropped out of sight. I don't know why, I just wasn't inspired to do much, but I felt fine. Hope everybody else came through it unscathed. I don't know that we're totally through it, but things are getting better. So, and I think it's good for me to paint. Puts me in a good frame of mind. It's kind of feels like what I should be doing. You know, you can get going sideways real quick when you've got a lot of projects and responsibilities around the house and stuff. Sidetracked, but you know, what's more important? A creative outlet or, you know, working in a garden? Well, they're both kind of creative, but for me, it's definitely painting. I get a lot out of it, so even if it can be at times a wee bit monotonous, you want to change up your brush stroke frequently. I don't think I want to just recreate the exact same thing throughout this work. So I'm going to lay the brush down flat and pull it. And that's the whole side of this is almost an inch long, these bristles from the side. And what I don't really want, you don't see very often in nature, is a definitive pattern. It's pretty darn random, so that's my approach to it. Also, I want to be kind of random. I don't want to just go back, do the same thing at every passage. I want a different look. A part of that, of course, comes with changing my palette. Changing the colors I'm using, but also your approach to putting it down clearly. And occasionally we just need to make a change. Just so that we create a little new interest for ourselves, get revitalized. It's, you know, if you're going to get bored, that's not a good thing. So to keep my interest going, I'm gonna change up my colors and look at painting something else in the distance for a minute. And I'm kind of graying my green. One good gray for that is babies, because to me it has a green in it. So I get a kind of a gray green here. And gray green's good for a lot of distance because it doesn't have a lot of intensity, chroma.